Today on Blue Values TV, we're going to deal with the difficult subject of human trafficking and a little bit about domestic violence. It's a difficult topic to think about and talk about, but this is something that we all need to understand because it goes on right here in Placer County. So stay tuned. Welcome to Blue Values TV. Blue Values TV is a production of the Blue Values Coalition, a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization dedicated to informing, educating, and engaging our neighbors in the governance of our communities. Look for us on the web at www.bluevaluescoalition.org. With us today are two wonderful people that deal with victims of human trafficking and domestic violence. Let me introduce Nilda Valmore. Mm-hmm. Is that right? You're the executive director of My Sister's House in Sacramento, California.
That's correct.
And Michelle Coleman, mm-hmm. You're the executive director of Stand Up Placer right here in Placer County in Auburn and in Roseville.
Correct.
Very good. Thank you for being with us here today. Let's talk a little bit to define what we're dealing with here. Human trafficking. How much of a problem is it right here in Sacramento and Placer County? What is it, and why is it something that all of us need to be aware of?
It's a big problem, and an important problem to address because people consider it, and obviously including My Sister's House, is modern day slavery, and especially slavery affecting a lot of women and young girls.
Absolutely, and it's not just in Sacramento County. Placer County, we also have trafficking issues. It relates, of course, to the 80 and 5 intersection, and the fact that trafficking is becoming a bigger deal even in a lot of criminal sectors in our country now. It's not just it's sex trafficking, and it's also labor trafficking. Human beings who are being sold as if they were property.
And they're basically performing not necessarily just sex acts and sex trade, but they're also being used as domestic workers and factory labor and whatever.
Absolutely, absolutely. And treat it much like a piece of property.
And often these victims of human trafficking are engaged in activities that may be considered illegal. They're not only victims of human trafficking, but they might be doing something that, in a sense, can be seen as criminal. And so how are these treated by the law enforcement agencies that we have? Are they treated more as victims or as criminals or both? And is there, how does law enforcement deal with that?
I know in Placer County, there are several law enforcement entities as well as the Sheriff's Department, and I know that they work very closely with the FBI because they understand what's going on in this area, and they understand that an individual who is selling their bodies for sex, that there may be other issues going on for them. So though it is still a crime, the officers are trying to pay attention and bringing in organizations like Stand Up Placer in these situations to work with the individuals to develop a level of confidence in us so they can talk to us and we can find out what's really going on. You won't often find an individual who is doing the sex crime calling themselves a trafficking victim.
Sure.
So we have to talk through a lot of questions and get some clarity before they might not even understand that they're a trafficking victim. They just know that they are doing something because they think they have to do it because they're frightened, they're threatened, their family's threatened, and they think that they have to do what they're doing in order to keep everyone safe.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to add to that. I think that we've gotten a lot better that law enforcement, at least from the top up, is recognizing that human trafficking is a big issue and something that they need to be concerned about. And I think that now we have to make sure that the line law enforcement recognizes the signs of human trafficking. Sometimes that's very difficult to do, and it does take a lot of education and pressure. And sometimes human trafficking occurs in institutions that seem legal, so activities that seem legal. So maybe it's like, for example, in a restaurant, you know, and that looks like a legal activity, but it's the way they do it, that's mm-hmm. what's different. And there's also, like, for example, the issue of some arranged marriages, which are a lot of force and fraud and coercion, the elements of human trafficking, bringing over a bride from another country purposely for the intent of abusing them. And so on the face, it looks like a legal activity. And so the women may be accepting that, but underneath, when you push the issue, you realize that there's an enslavement that's going on.
Now, Nilda, your agency, My Sister's House, is specialized in a way and is equipped to help victims of sexual abuse, domestic violence, human trafficking, especially for those people coming from the Asia-Pacific region. Can you tell us about some of the specialties you have there, and why is it that these are especially important to be able to serve?
Sure. We were started about 12, 13 years ago because of some high-profile incidents that occurred in the Sacramento area. We're the only domestic violence shelter serving the central Northern California area, focusing on the needs of Asian Pacific Islander victims of domestic violence and human trafficking. And the reason why that it's was necessary, like with these high-profile incidents, is that there was a belief from community leaders that these victims didn't know where to go for help, mm-hmm. didn't know how to access help, and didn't feel comfortable receiving the help.
How do people come into your shelters? Do they walk in and say, "I need some help"? Are they referred by friends and family or neighbors, or are they referred by law enforcement? What do you find is the way that people enter your services?
Well, at Stand Up Placer, we have a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week crisis line. And so individuals can call and say, "I need shelter." Often our partners in the community, the hospitals, the other human services agencies, will refer them to us. And also law enforcement will also call us after a call and say, you know, we have someone who should be there. We also have a program which is called Divert, where anytime an officer in Placer County goes to a call at a house for domestic violence, they send us information about that call so that we can reach out to the survivor and let them know that there are services available to them.
And how would you break it down? Do the majority of the cases come just on their own, or are they mostly referred by others?
I was speaking to a group Saturday, and I was thinking about four trafficking cases. Mm-hmm. And what I realized they all had in common was that there was some friend or some neighbor, someone who was, you know, a lifesaver for that victim of human trafficking. Mm-hmm. So I think, especially with human trafficking, I think there needs to be an intermediary person who helps make that connection, sometimes drives them over, but recognizes the signs of human trafficking and recognizing that that's a victim in peril. With domestic violence, I think that more often than not, we usually probably have more women that will call themselves directly when they're ready to get help.
So there's a distinction. So if most of the victims, or if you're seeing a large number of victims of human trafficking being really referred to you by other people, it's very important for people to recognize the signs of human trafficking. So what are those? And how can everyday people know that, hey, maybe this odd behavior that I'm seeing, what are these odd behaviors I should look for that might give me a clue that this is what's going on?
Well, similar. The person is controlled. The person does not have the ability to go and come on their own. They don't have control of their money. They don't have the control of their bank accounts. They are isolated from people around them. They're working all the time and never seem to have anything to show for that. Some of the signs that we look for. Mm-hmm. When they can't talk about where they really live or where they're from, when there's always someone with them, be it because they need help with translation, someone to make sure they don't say the wrong thing.
Mm-hmm. And it's not the case for all immigrant women, but you know, unfortunately, there a lot of immigrant women are a prime target for being victims of human trafficking, and that's so that could be a red flag. Like, and if they don't have control of their papers, that's definitely a red flag. I think also finding out about how were they brought over. You know, was it a quick relationship? Was it over the internet? Was mm-hmm. it because the partner was vacationing in a foreign country purposely for looking for a bride or a wife or a girlfriend? Those are all some additional signs. If the woman never comes out of the house, but you see a figure behind the house, those can be signs. If the house has a lot of high security, that could be a sign. And we haven't even talked about the whole massage parlor syndrome and the brothels and so forth. But those are also signs of human trafficking.
And also, if they have bruises and they are battered, as you know, when you see someone who's always recovering from a beating, that is also a sign that there's violence happening in the house.
And that could be either human trafficking or severe domestic violence.
Yes.
Either way, that's someone that needs help.
Right.
That point. So suppose that you see some signs like this. I think a lot of people tend to be reluctant to act on that information because, in a way, they're afraid that this is really not my business, this is a private affair and stuff. What would you say to neighbors or people who see this kind of thing, who may wonder what's going on? What would you like to see them do? Do they go knock on the door and explore more, or what would you recommend?
Well, I would not recommend they knock on the door, because
good.
Not only is it not safe for them, but they might be putting that individual in peril as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that Nelda and I talk about that often, about what is the best way to go with that. And I think that starting with law enforcement, I mean, law enforcement can keep track of what's going on, and they can do some inquiries that we can't do. But also, if you have an opportunity, if the individual is out somewhere, and you can let them know about the resources that are available, that's also another way to go. Like Nilda said, someone being the intermediary, someone saying you might want to talk to, or taking them there if that's something that can be done in a safe manner.
Mm-hmm.
And I think like calling local law enforcement is really critical, you know, getting them involved and, you know, giving whatever information that you can about the situation is very important. Like, you know, what size that they think that there may be a victim in hiding there or in need of help. I would say it's better to that person who might be thinking that they know someone, it's better to be safe than sorry, mm-hmm. and end somebody's misery, and please do get involved. I'm thinking of a recent case, and so thankful that a person opened their door to someone knocking really hard on their door so that they could escape from the situation, and they only had a moment of time, and thankful that at that house that they called my sister's house, so that we could guide that person into receiving services. So they don't have to call my sister's house, they could call Stand Up Placer, but they need to call someone to get
right.
to get that help. And the benefit of calling a domestic violence shelter is that we're trained on a lot of safety issues, and we work together so that we can provide the best possible resources that we can for that survivor defenseman.
Now, I want to go into the help that your organizations provide, but before we do that, mm-hmm. Suppose that you do call law enforcement. In your experience, is the response of law enforcement fairly positive? Will they take it seriously? Is it going to be, are they going to be hassling you about, hey, what's the data that you have, and so on? And how will law enforcement respond to such a call?
You know, sort of like Nelda said, that there are, the leadership is really fully bought in, but there are a lot of young officers.
Mm-hmm.
But if you see someone in danger, you know, how much are you willing to do to get to the next step to make sure that someone is taken care of? So it's, I would say, get, like Nilda said, get all the information you can, and you give it to them, and you follow up on that, and you see what's happening. We are citizens, and the law enforcement is here to keep us safe
right.
and to keep our neighbors safe. So we have the right to ask them if they're doing that. And also reaching out to the agency in the community. If we were to hear, if someone called law enforcement and they heard nothing and nothing happened, we would want them to call us because we would want to get involved in that. It's part of our goal is not just to help people after things have happened, but to be as preventative as possible. I don't want to talk about someone that we've lost. I want to talk about someone that has been moved on to the next level of their life.
So that's a good point. Besides calling law enforcement, they can call your organizations directly.
Yes.
And let you know.
Yeah, we definitely want them to call our organizations directly so that we can provide the services to the victim.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's talk about the next step, and that is once your organization has been called and you've gotten a person that you think does need your help, what are the services that you provide?
And can I
go ahead? Mm-hmm.
Begin? So I just want to say, like, if somebody calls and, for example, the woman may be Vietnamese or Korean, you know, they just need to leave a phone number and the language, and then we will call them back with someone who can speak that language. I think it's important that the telephone be picked up, though, because our number will say restricted. And so that could be a stumbling block if they don't pick up the telephone. And the services that we provide are similar to, I think, and Michelle will comment, the services Stand Up Plaster provide is counseling, shelter, information on how to get back on their feet financially, some emergency services, safety planning, you know, basically a continuous services. So hopefully that they can begin the healing process and really rebuild their lives into one of safety and not one based on fear.
Similar programs, but you would call our crisis line, which is 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and the individual on the end of the crisis line can make arrangements for that person to go to a safe place so that we can pick them up and bring them to the safe house if that's the appropriate next step. In our safe house, we have all the services, the counseling, the case management, therapy, groups, some job training. And the whole idea is that every individual who seeks our services has a different need.
Right.
And so it's very individualized, and we're working with them to build the future that they want to see, the safe and healthy future for themselves.
Now, once you get called about a person who may potentially be a victim of human trafficking, you're going to try to call them, but if they're always with another person, how do you try to get through without them being controlled or having them answer the phone instead of their slave owner, if you will, or whoever?
So in my mind, when you first asked the question, I actually thought that the person was might have gone to a neighbor's house or something for safety. It's a lot harder. The process takes a lot longer if they have not been able to mm-hmm. Escape yet. And there's obviously a lot more questions or issues that might happen. And sometimes it's, you know, every situation is different.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's that woman running into the street yelling for help.
Right.
And that thankfully maybe law enforcement just happens to be nearby.
Happens to be there.
Yeah.
Sure. And sometimes it is, I agree, that if they are still in the midst of the situation,
yeah.
It's not going to be just we're going to call you back. It's
right.
going to be because we're probably getting the call from the neighbor or the friend.
Exactly.
So we are then talking through some strategies with safety planning about, okay, how might we create a situation where she can be somewhere by herself or take a call. And like Nilda said, that definitely is not something that you can expect is going to happen this minute, this hour, and it might be a while paying attention and trying to get it done. But at the same time, we're also staying in touch with law enforcement and say, this is what we really believe, this is what we're seeing, what are you doing, what can you do, is there something you can do? There are just so many different strategies to try to get them by themselves into a place where they can say, yes, I am in danger, without the individual in the room.
So can law enforcement actually help in those situations?
Depending on where we are at the situation, I would love to say it's cut and dry, and yes, law enforcement can, but depending on the situation, but they can definitely help more than they can hurt if they're willing to.
That sounds like a it's a difficult problem, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And there is no single solution to it. Now, the services that you provide for people in this situation, they're not just a one-day thing or a two-day thing. Mm-hmm. This is a long effort to basically get someone back on their feet, back to being independent, back to having the self-respect and so on that they need to survive. Can you talk about the services that you provide and how long they last, as well as maybe how many people do you actually help in this area?
Well, in our safe house, we have 40 beds, which means that individuals can stay in that safe house for up to 3 months. And then at that point, it's decided that they need more help and more support. We have transitional housing where they can stay in that program for up to 2 years. And while they're in there, they have the therapy, they have the case management, they have work with financial planning and job readiness. Mm-hmm. And it's our goal that when they leave at the end of the 2 years, that they have made some decisions and made some steps toward the next steps in their lives. And we find a lot of the individuals in our transitional housing end up going back to school or going to training programs, and the goal is livable wages and a life where they can build a future.
And if there are children involved also, the children get to stay with the parent?
Absolutely. And our shelter and our transitional housing, children from birth up until the age of 18 stay with the mother or father. I'm sorry.
So we, at my sister's house, we have a 6-bed shelter, and thanks to Sir Optimus of the Sierra Nevada region, we were able to open a transitional house, which is also 6 beds. And I'm excited about that because I think the longer stay is especially helpful for traffic victims. Mm-hmm. The one thing that our services are similar is to what Michelle cited, and I think we haven't really emphasized our services of legal services, basically, for traffic victims, mm-hmm. Especially, and that's really critical, because sometimes women are afraid to leave because, like, they're afraid of being deported, mm-hmm. They're afraid of their visa issues, right? And you asked about how long it takes, and that whole process of certification takes a long time.
Yeah.
That is not in their control whatsoever. That's one of the benefits of the transitional house, because it allows us to work through those legal matters that, again, is not due to their fault. And thankfully, there is federal legislation which allows for a victim of human trafficking to get some legal remedies so that they don't have to worry about those issues and can really feel like that they could get some help.
Yeah. And we actually have the same. We have the same legal services. We have a couple of pro bono attorneys who give us hours. We're very fortunate here in Placer County. Yes.
Terrific. We talked about the faces of domestic violence and human trafficking. We didn't talk about what the faces are not. And what I mean by that is that there's no age. Victims of human trafficking and domestic violence can be extremely young and extremely old. And you have some data on that from 2013.
Well, absolutely. I was sharing with you that in our shelter, we had 4 babies that were actually born and came home from the hospital to our shelter. And we also had 3 women that were elderly that were in our shelter.
Right.
Our victims of trafficking, I think people have a vision of what that looks like. But one victim that we served last year was a 6-foot blonde with blue eyes. That's not what people assume.
Right.
So if you see it happening, don't assume they have to look a certain way to help them.
That's exactly my point. There is no one picture of these victims. It can be anyone. So the thing to really look for is the behaviors that you talked about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I do want to add, though, I think that there are some reports that talk about in terms of where they come from, that there's a large majority that come from Asian countries for mm-hmm. a variety of reasons. The other thing that I want to add with regards to statistics is we can share you the statistics of who we've been able to serve as clients of our shelter or who receive our counseling services and so forth, but we don't really even get to the clients that we the victims that we haven't been able to serve,
right?
Either because they haven't called, or for some of them, they've called or they've been in contact with us, but they're not willing to or able or courageous enough yet to receive the help, you know, because of whatever fearful situations that they've been. And do you count them as a victim of human trafficking even though they haven't accessed help? I do.
I do too, sure.
Absolutely.
Still victims even if they're not receiving help,
right?
Very good. Any other, I guess the last question I wanted to ask is, one more time, if you know someone that you suspect might be a victim, the way for them is to contact you guys first, contact law enforcement, and can you give us a phone number for both of your organizations for them to contact you, Nilda?
Sure, our phone number is 916-428-3271. 916-428-3271. And definitely please call if it's a, if they think that there's a victim of human trafficking. If they think it might be situational, like for example, if they might think it's a place like a massage parlor or a brothel, then definitely call law enforcement for this.
Okay. And that's 24 hours?
Yes, ours is a 24/7 multilingual helpline, yes.
Excellent.
Okay.
Michelle?
It's 530-823-6224.
Okay. And that's also 24 hours?
No, actually, that's our 9 to 5. That's the one where we would take care if they think it's happening. If the individual is calling, then they would call our crisis line number.
Very good. Thank you very much for being with us today. And thank you for joining us today on Blue Values TV. Until next time, good night.